old Russia. More than 1,000 years cultural history in Eastern Europe. It is preserved in the castles, monasteries, and churches, and in the hearts of the people. Notwithstanding tyrants and dictators, the inhabitants of this vast country have cultivated a lasting relationship with their homeland and traditions, their Russian soul. This river made Novgorod the capital of an important trading republic. The Volkhov connected the Baltic Sea with the Black Sea, and thus with Byzantium, the Orient, and Africa. More than 1,000 years ago, the Viking prince Rurik founded Novgorod, the new city on the banks of the Volkhov. From then on, important trading routes were controlled by the princes in the Kremlin, making the city rich and opening it to new cultural influences. Without its long nautical tradition, Novgorod's existence would be unthinkable. The inhabitants cultivate their city's heritage. The Young Sailors Club has been training young men and women in matters nautical since 1967.
We used to be in the Young Sailors Club too, so we know how valuable the contact and the camaraderie are and what they mean. Former members stay friends and go on voyages together.
The Young Sailors Club dates from a time when the Soviet Union was, for many citizens, the model for a happy, secure world. The club promoted the nautical, communal, and moral education of young people. And it played a special role in the lives of Elena and Alexander Volkhov, and not just in relation to their love of the sea.
We met many years ago through the club. I was still at school, and then Alexander Alexeyevich joined our crew as the instructor for electromechanics.
The memories of those days are not only firmly anchored in the Volkhovs' hearts, but also in the display cases of the Sailors Club. Today, the Volkhov children also attend the Seaman's School.
Сынуля, младший, приходит с плавания.
Our youngest son is due back from a 12-day voyage today. I'm preparing a treat for him, pancakes. He loves sweet things like bonbons, lollies, and pancakes. Maxim's been in the Young Sailors Club for a year. This is the first time he's been allowed to go on a trip without us.
This is the Sasha Kovalyov with which we were in the North Sea, in the Baltic, the White Sea, and Murmansk. The photo was taken in Finland. Elena was 17 at the time.
Here, this is Alexander teaching at the club in his lovely uniform. How old are you on this photo?
No idea. Not the foggiest.
Already as a student, I decided that he was going to be my husband. He had no chance of escape.
Soon, their 10-year-old will be returning to port. They'll have to hurry. The parents arrive just in time. The ship approaches, accompanied by brass band music. After 2 weeks and over 200 sea miles, the Mikhail Balaban docks once more in Novgorod harbor.
Oh, sure we could burst into tears. This tune, they used to play it when we put to sea.
A ship like a time capsule. In the club and on board, the good old Soviet Union seems alive and well. The crew consists of 23 children aged between 10 and 15. Maxim is one of the youngest. You can see at once how the children have changed. They're more disciplined and self-confident. Whether it lasts, we'll see at home.
This was their first sea voyage. We set some new records on this trip. Volkov Maxim.
Brusov Dmitry.
Company at ease. Did you actually want to come home? You've even got an insignia. Now it's Dad's turn.
A quick change of clothes, then it's off home.
The whole voyage was great. Even the food was good.
And what was clearing the decks like?
That wasn't much fun because they were so strict. But I want to go on another voyage and hold out to the end, now that I've started.
It's his decision, but if he wants to carry on, of course I've got nothing against it. The club not only makes the children into good sailors, but also decent people. Novgorod is one of the oldest cities in Russia. According to the legend, Scandinavians were frequent visitors, coming across the river by rowing boat. The people on the Volkov called them Rus, or rowers. They asked their leader, Rurik, to preside over them as prince. This is the origin of the name Russia. Under the regency of Yaroslav the Wise, the heart of Novgorod was created. The Kremlin, built in the 11th century and still the center point of the city today. Above all, in summer, the citadel draws many visitors and is a meeting point for the city's inhabitants. The fields around the Kremlin and the park inside are popular for walking and relaxing against the historical backdrop. In the center of the complex, the National Monument from 1862 commemorates 1,000 years of Russia. The commission went to the virtually unknown young Mikhail Mikeshin, who was able to showcase his talent in the pompous work. New challenges are also what drives the self-taught blacksmith Sergei Zasonov. Originally a wood carver, working with metal was at first problematic. For each kind of metal, you have to find the right approach so that it gives in to you. Copper is as moody as Venus, the goddess of love. It's unpredictable, which is why we blacksmiths don't like working with it. Even harder to handle is iron, the metal of the planet Mars. I didn't start working with iron until I'd mastered copper, a bit like the Bronze Age being superseded by the Iron Age. Hammer, anvil, and metal strips are Sergei's most important instruments. The autodidact in the art of forging metal is outside the Novgorod Kremlin a few times a week. He enjoys the interest shown by his customers and is trying to preserve old knowledge. In the past, the customers wanted well-made, practical objects, which is why the smiths had to work with iron alloys, because that's the only way to guarantee good quality. The method was simple. You took a piece of iron and cut it into strips, and then put the strips in a swamp for a year, where they would be enriched with carbon and hardened. Then the rust was removed and the iron forged to make a good sword. With his old-fashioned weaponry, Sergei supplements his meager pension. A handmade knife costs 1,500 rubles, about 34 euros, for a week's work. I found the history of the northern knife especially fascinating. Novgorod wasn't isolated, but was exposed to widely differing influences, and the locals absorbed the best of them. It was above all the Scandinavians who left their traces here. The downwards pointing tip, the course of the blade, their knives had to be very practical, and for that reason weren't very big. Sergei is proud to live in a city that even produced its own kind of knife. This discovery was his biggest motivation. The only way to learn how to forge metal properly is to practice. And you have to have the will. As the saying goes, aims are achieved not by those who can, but by those who want to. The shops are full of knives made with modern technology, where the hands aren't used at all. It's all done with lasers and machine tools. The knives look perfect, but they have no soul. The 1.5 kilometer long city wall is redolent of past battles fought by Novgorod, whose citizens often had to defend themselves against enemies. To give thanks for the victory against the mounted tribes of the Pechenegs in 1045, a wooden church was built, which was soon replaced by the stone version. From the 12th to the 15th century, the St. Sophia Cathedral was the spiritual center of the Republic of Novgorod, which extended from the Baltic to the Ural Mountains. Located on the trading route to the Bosphorus, the church is dedicated to both Holy Wisdom and St. Sophia in Byzantium. The centuries-old painted frescoes and icons in the cathedral's interior were barely noticed in the Soviet Union. The church was used as a museum, and its inventory gathered dust. After perestroika, restorers began to bring the precious Christian artifacts back to life. Tatiana Romashkiewicz is something like the queen of the restorers. With the permission of the Metropolitan, for 2 years she's worked in the cathedral's inner sanctum, behind the iconostasis.
The first time I was here with my class at school, and we looked at the old frescoes. On the way upstairs, I suddenly found myself standing in front of the portrait of King Solomon, eye to eye. His expression and the look on his face have accompanied me ever since.
The beautifully decorated base of the original altar in the old church was recently discovered under the altar room. Only Tatiana Romashkiewicz is allowed to work on it.
I'm in the process of cleaning off all the dirt that's still on it, plaster and whatever organic matter is on there. And after that, the salt efflorescence will be removed from the surface. That will allow much more of the painting to be seen and the colors will be stronger.
In her workshop, 125 square meters of debris await Tatiana's attention. The remains of a gigantic fresco from a medieval church. In their entirety, the fragments, some tiny, are impressive evidence of their time.
This is a classical composition with two elements typical for Novgorod. Look how the people are waiting to be baptized, although Jesus has already appeared. The people are waiting, preparing calmly for their baptism, taking their shirts and boots off. For them, the appearance of Jesus is no miracle, but something perfectly natural. That's how the Novgorodovs were. On the one hand, extremely pious and thoughtful. On the other, they never forgot the everyday aspects of life.
The bells of St. Sophia's Cathedral sound right next door to Tatiana's workshop. The western portal boasts bronze doors from Magdeburg, masterpieces from the 12th century, which were originally ordered for the cathedral in the Polish city of Plock. How they ended up in Novgorod is unclear. The 26 panels depict biblical scenes from the Old and New Testaments, as well as luminaries from the period, like Bishop Alexander of Plock, who originally commissioned the doors. The two smiths also took the opportunity to immortalize themselves. At the time, bronze founders were significant artists. Ancient artisanry meets modern aesthetics. Slava Smirnov still has to make his reputation. In a rented garage, he's been welding and soldering for weeks on a new sculpture. At the moment, he rarely sees daylight. Yes, I'm obsessed by metals. When I was being trained as a woodcarver, I went into a smithy. And after that, I never touched a piece of wood again. I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the magic of the fire. And maybe that one wants to feel strong and master the material. The sculpture is a commission for Novgorod's local TV station. The metal cameraman is due to be unveiled in just a few days' time. Slava has to keep at it. It's the struggle with oneself. The conditions in my studio, there's dirt, flying sparks, fiery flames. It's a sort of silly romanticism that's existed since the Stone Age. With wood, you just take a sharp knife and cut off what's superfluous. You can't do that with metal. You need strength. The best place for Slava to recharge his batteries and find peace is at home with his family and friends. Even though there's never much money, his wife supports him. And for his son, he's a hero. I never thought I'd be an artist and earn my living with art. So many things happened by accident. At one particular time in my life, I made a decision to stop working and concentrate on art. And in the end, art began to give me a living. The day of the unveiling. Slava has scarcely slept in the last 36 hours. The first curious passers-by steal a look at the sculpture before it's transported to its new home. No easy task at 300 kilos. The premises of the Novgorod local broadcaster are on the edge of town. Slava's client is waiting eagerly for the sculpture. He's invested a lot of money in Slava's work. It all began with classical sculptures, a bit more academic. I've known Slava a long time.
There are lots of sculptures in metal, but he has great artistic talent. I like his style. I suggested he did something on a large scale, and it's worked out really well. This isn't Slava's first public commission. His work is on display at various points in the city, but there's never been a sculpture of this size. 8 strong men are required to heave the metal colossus into place. Then it all happens very quickly. Slava only has to weld on the supports, and then he can finally enjoy the fruits of his labor and the sculpture itself. The biggest challenge is the piece's weight and unwieldiness. It was enormously difficult to turn. Now I feel fantastic. Everything's done, everything's welded, nothing got broken, the light is great. So now I feel enormous satisfaction. Slava's cameraman will in future keep watch over the entrance, as the Kremlin has for centuries over the west bank of the Volkhov. The opposite bank of the river saw the spread of the industrial area. The arcades of the Yaroslav court once marked the borders of the marketplace. Novgorod was an industrial hub, and the merchants had their own churches built in stone, a privilege otherwise only granted to princes. In one of the oldest city centers in the world, archaeologists have for 50 years been laying bare traces of medieval trade. Sergei Troyanovsky is leading the excavations. We have a pretty harsh climate here. The big lake nearby means the town gets a lot of precipitation. And water is the best means of conserving something, which means that all the old remains were preserved for us, including birch bark, leather, and all organic materials. This situation is unique, as in other cities only glass, metal, and stone is left over, and we have to laboriously work our way through layers dried out by contact with oxygen. The ground in Novgorod is unusually rich in finds. Every season, new artifacts are discovered on a daily basis. This plan shows our finds day by day. Today, for example, we've discovered an amber pearl from the Baltic and a stone that was used by fishermen to weigh down their nets. Here we have an almost completely preserved shoe of considerable size, and we've got the sole too. That fits perfectly. It's probably around size 43. We've also found extremely elegant footwear. Women must always have loved luxury items like this. You can see the traces of the ornamentation that was embroidered in colorful threads. It's the start of the school summer holidays. The excavations are a popular holiday job with children, a sort of paid treasure hunt. For 2 weeks, they dig for 4 hours a day. I'm taking part in the dig because I like working in the fresh air and looking for archaeological remains. And because of the money, of course.
It is interesting to find out more about the history of my home city and how it used to be here and what used to happen here.
I'm just interested in how people used to live back then. What did they do and what was their everyday life like? How did they entertain themselves and what did the children play with? What work did the adults do and how did they relax? After the winter break, the young people are preparing the ground for the excavations. From the end of June, groups of international students will take over the detail work. The written accounts of the early history of Novgorod are very patchy. All the chronicles that we have only start from about the 14th century. We can only find out about the people and their lives before that through archaeology. And Novgorod has one fantastic source of information, the birch bark documents. Birch bark was a widely used writing material. Not only the nobles and the clergy could read and write, but the common people too, a situation only to be found elsewhere in the metropolis of Constantinople. In Novgorod, the Hanseatic League had several offices, including the German Peterhof. Where I'm standing now once ran one of the city's main thoroughfares. It was called Varyagskaya, and this name is derived from the first foreign merchants in Novgorod, the Varangians or Scandinavians. In the 12th century came the Germans, who lived in one of two places. One of them is the German Yard or Peterhof. The merchants enjoyed each other's hospitality, and both groups cultivated a tradition of brewing beer. And when they later, somewhat inebriated, returned home along this street, they would have terrific fights with the locals. For Sergei Troyanovsky, the city's rich past is more than just a chapter in a history book. Every stone and every shard of glass reveals a little more of old Novgorod and the lives of its citizens. These are very interesting details about Novgorod shoes, knitted woolen inlays for boots that were probably used to warm the wearer's feet in winter. They date from the 13th century. They are, of course, unique finds, one-offs, because no one has found anything similar so far. The Republic of Novgorod was ruled by noble merchants who lived mainly from tolls. A second power was the people's representatives, the Vetcher, in which non-nobles were also authorized to vote. The assembly took place in the open area between the churches and made decisions about war and peace, and even the regency of distant principalities. The surrounding swamp and forest areas were home to the Slavic settlers. They lived from fishing, fur trapping, and timber, as wood was the main material for building. The open-air museum on the southern edge of the city contains exact reproductions of churches, corn silos, chapels and farmhouses from the last centuries. The citizens of Novgorod were well known for their own style of architecture and their unusual wood-carving skills. Up to the 15th century, theirs was one of the leading cultures of Europe. Vladimir Yarish isn't looking for wood to build with, but birch bark. May and June are the months for harvesting. I'm actually originally a musician. All my life I've studied and taught accordion. Then a friend gave me something made of birch bark for my birthday, and it suddenly clicked. It's hard to explain, but maybe we all spend our lives looking for the right material. Suitable birches are to be found in mixed forests. Their trunks are smooth and tall. When harvesting, Vladimir takes care that the trees don't get damaged. Here there are good layers of bark. Separating the bark from the tree hasn't hurt it. If you look here, you can see at once that at some point the bark was removed, probably 4 to 5 years ago. Generally speaking, after removal, a tree needs 8 or 9 years to be able to produce bark again. This tree will continue to grow and thrive, like the other birches too. Before Vladimir can go harvesting in the forest, he needs a permit from the forestry authority. They allocate a particular section to him, and he can then seek out the birch trees he wants. The bark can be different colors, yellow or red. We take the one closer to yellow, that's a bit softer. Originally from Kazakhstan, Vladimir is above all interested in peasant traditions. The people in the country used birch bark for many everyday objects. They made different kinds of baskets from the bark, or bottle-like containers that were used to store linseeds for oil production. The most interesting birch bark product for me is this tursok, or water bottle. Let me try it out. I pour water into it, and no leaks. If you poured hot soup into it, it would stay warm for half a day. Cold liquids stay cool until the evening. A tursok was something like a thermos flask. Great, isn't it? The stripped-off birch bark is fairly easy to work with. In the past, the Novgoroders would use sheets of it as insulating material or for the foundations of their houses. Cut into strips, various different utensils can be pleated from it. Children's toys were also made this way. In no time, Vladimir fashions a baby's rattle. In the 13th and 14th centuries, Novgorod achieved the standard of living of European cities, like, for example, Amsterdam. Trade flourished and the workshops produced elegant and really aesthetically pleasing products from birch bark. After a while, I realized that Novgorod was the only city where I could really live and dedicate myself to my craft. The birch bark stands for a highly developed medieval society from which the whole country benefited. Vladimir wants to return this handicraft to its rightful place in Russian history. For Vladimir, birch bark art is a Russian tradition that contributes to the national identity. When we go to Holland and see clogs, we realize that we're dealing with Dutch people. And when you come to Russia, and above all to Novgorod, and you see us pursuing birch bark crafts, then you should know at once that we're Russians. To the south of the city, where the Volkhov flows out of Lake Ilmen, the Church of St. George in the Yuriev Monastery towers over the flat surrounding landscape. Here historians wrote parts of the first Novgorod chronicle. In the Second World War, German and Spanish troops took refuge here. In 1991, the monks moved back in and have renovated the complex step by step. Lake Ilmen connects Novgorod to the Baltic Sea and the Russian interior by means of more than 50 rivers. Many families in the region have lived for generations from fishing. On Sundays and holidays, the Novgoroders like to use the waters for leisure purposes. Fisherman Andrei is expecting relatives. That's it now, we've got to get going.
What are all these ropes for?
To keep strangers out. Hello.
I hope you're well.
Careful, careful. Hello. Andrei's father and grandfather were fishermen. He's been putting to sea every day for the last 10 years, even on his days off. The ever-changing seasons mean the area never gets boring. In the spring, the amount of water in Lake Ilmen increases three or fourfold. The floods transform the extensive plain into a huge lake and riverscape. The island of Lipna lies in a nature reserve and is spared the yearly high tides. The Tabunov family have lived on the island for more than 80 years. Their houses are regularly cut off from the mainland for months by water or ice. The seclusion doesn't bother Margarita Tabunova at all.
I grew up here and can't really imagine living in the city anymore. I want to be in nature, away from the rush and bustle of humanity.
Novgorod is 8 kilometers away as the crow flies. The journey takes nearly an hour by motorboat. As an experienced civil engineer, Margarita knows the problems of the marshy Novgorod soil. She designed all these houses herself, including the planning and the calculations. The only thing her sons had to do was erect them when they weren't away fishing. Thanks to her parents, Margarita learned early on what an independent rural life meant.
It's much harder to survive in the city than here in the country, as the wages are low, and here you can get everything from nature. Fish, potatoes, vegetables. You're self-sufficient.
In the early Middle Ages, the island was inhabited by monks seeking a secluded spot to pray. All that is left of the monastery is a church, and Margarita looks after the ruin.
We write down the temperature levels and humidity and pass them on to the authorities. If there's something wrong, they send specialists who deal with the problem. We're not in charge, they have their own custodian. We just keep an eye on it, so it doesn't disappear overnight.
Margarita earns a little money from catering for visitors. The tourists can register by mobile phone.
We have lots of visitors from the city who come to eat fresh fish, be it fried, smoked, gratiné or in soup. We offer popular dishes.
Andrei, too, has booked fish soup for his family. The vegetation on Lipna uses the short summer period for extremely intensive growth. After the march through the jungle, the guests can look forward to sander soup with potatoes and vegetables, all caught or grown by the Tabunovas themselves.
With the groups that come over once a week, I can compensate for the lack of company very well. I can chat and swap news with them. But when they're gone, I'm happy to have a week's peace.
From the church tower, the monks had a very good view of the surrounding waters. The church is dedicated to St. Nicholas, patron saint of travelers and mariners in Russia. Modern Novgorod has its own airfield, a popular destination for summer excursions. At the weekend, parachutists and their families flock to the former military base. Bookkeeper Olga Yegorova is a member of the close community of parachutists with over 1,000 jumps to her name. In summer, she trains up to 3 times a week, as she's hoping to become Russian champion.
The start of the season is especially exciting because the winter break is over and we haven't jumped for ages. The fear comes back, just like the very beginning. But that usually goes again during the jump because your experience takes the upper hand and orders your thoughts. You just have to jump. I can't explain it. The feeling of flying is like nothing else. You just have to try it.
The only airworthy plane at the airstrip takes off up to 7 times a day. The Antonov II, a single-engined double-decker, was developed in the Soviet Union after the Second World War. The Antonov is known for its reliability, or at least it was. Professional parachutists are used to improvising and mucking in together. Up to now, they've always got the old Soviet plane going again.
A lot of people like the nice atmosphere at the airstrip. It's like a family. Quite a few couples have met here and children have been the result. We have a saying, if your job gets in the way of jumping, then quit your job. And it's just like that in your private life too. If your boy or girlfriend doesn't like you skydiving, then it's obviously not a match made in heaven.
The AN-2 is perfect for the short runway at the Novgorod airfield. After a few hundred meters, it's airborne. The double-decker climbs to a height of 900 meters, then it's time for the first jumps. Each jumper has their own height. Olga is last to go, at 3,000 meters. Thank you.
Free fall is what I love best. You have to do a lot of work in order not to just plummet like a stone. In comparison, landing is dead easy. There's no more risk, and you know you're returning to Earth alive and healthy. It's like coming home. I don't know why, but free fall is just the best.
I'm never going to jump with this old chute again. Olga is happy and relieved. Everything went fine. This is also down to her own thoroughness. She takes folding her parachute very seriously. It does, after all, decide between life and death.
Once my chute didn't open and I had to use my reserve. But you don't realize how quickly time passes. I always thought if anything happens to me, then I'd chuck it in at once. So far, I've only had a few bruises. On my second jump, I banged my hip so badly that it was black and blue for months afterwards. But I don't let things like that get in the way. I wouldn't dream of stopping.
To the south of Novgorod, a ruined castle looms over the river. It marks the birthplace of the Russian Empire. 1100 years ago, this was the center of power of the Viking prince Rurik, who began the first line of Russian rulers, the Rurikid dynasty. In the 13th century, the riders of the Mongol Golden Horde brought the Rurikids under their rule, a suppression that continued for centuries. There is hardly any cultural evidence for the period under the heel of the Tatars. One of the few exceptions is the Church of the Redeemer on the Neredesa River. Prince Yaroslav had it built in 1198 in memory of his two dead sons. For this reason, all the frescoes are dedicated to the resurrection and eternal life. The restorer, Tatiana Romashkevich, knows the frescoes like no other.
This complete ensemble of wall paintings gives us an idea of the worldview of early medieval Russians, how they thought and lived and what influenced them.
In the Second World War, the German army turned the precious monument into a pile of rubble. Since 1956, restorers, art historians, and architects have been busy bringing the Church of the Redeemer back to life.
During the clearing up operation, the original stones, the rectangular medieval blocks of limestone, were sorted and each laid carefully in its original place. With the frescoes, it didn't go quite so well. A lot of people came to the ruin, and when they saw the fragments of fresco in the baskets, many people took them as souvenirs. In this way, half the original frescoes disappeared.
Tatiana began trying to sort out the gigantic jigsaw puzzle.
This is one of the best-known portraits from the 12th century. Here, the posture of the prince, a Rurik, he has the typical physiognomy. He looks very similar to Ivan the Terrible. Right here, this is where it all began, with these fragments. The next day, a piece of the robe was found.
In the pile of rubble?
Yes, yes. And it was still in the same place.
The years of work have paid off. The painters from Novgorod were renowned artists of the early Middle Ages. Thanks to flourishing trading links, there was an active exchange of ideas, and the advanced Byzantine culture was well known in Novgorod.
I've worked on many monuments in Moscow, in Yaroslav, in Tver. But the city that means most to me is Novgorod, the old monuments of Novgorod.
Out of the swampy land on the banks of Lake Ilmen and the Volkhov emerged the oldest of all Russian cities. Here, civil freedom and art developed to a greater extent than in any other region in Russia. After Novgorod, other larger, more significant metropolises developed. But nothing can take away Novgorod's history.